Yeah, bear with me as we skip through some of this. Probably not going to read the whole thing, so we're going to skip and be jumping around a little bit. Genesis 44. And he commanded the steward of his house, saying, "Fill the men's sacks with food, as much as they can carry, and put every man's money in his sack's mouth. And put my cup, the silver cup, in the sacks of the mouth of the youngest, and his corn money." And he did according to the word that Joseph had spoken. And as soon as the morning was light, the men were sent away, they and their asses. And when they were gone out of the city, and not yet afar off, Joseph said unto his steward, "Up, follow after the men. And when thou dost overtake them, say unto them, Wherefore have ye rewarded evil for good? Is not this it in which my Lord drinketh, and whereby indeed he divineth? Ye have done evil in so doing." And he overtook them, and he spake unto them these same words. Now verses 12 to 14. And he searched and began at the eldest and left at the youngest, and the cup was found in Benjamin's sack. And when they rent their clothes and laid in every man his ass and returned to the city, and Judah and his brethren came to Joseph's house, for he was yet there, and they fell before him on the ground. Verses 18 to 22. Then Judah came near unto him and said, "O my lord, let thy servant, I pray thee, speak a word in my lord's ears. And let not thine anger burn against thy servant, for thou art even as Pharaoh. My lord asked his servant, saying, Have ye a father or a brother? And we said unto my lord, We have a father, an old man, and a child of his old age, and a little one, and his brother is dead, and he alone is left of his mother, and his father loveth him. And thou sayest unto thy servants, Bring him down unto me, that I may set mine eyes upon him. And we said unto my lord, The lad cannot leave his father, for if he shall leave his father would die." Verses 33 to 34. "Now therefore I pray thee, let thy servant abide instead of the lad, a bondman to my lord, and let the lad go up with his brethren. For how shall I go up to my father, and the lad be not with me, lest peradventure I see the evil that shall come on my father?"
You may be seated. Perhaps one of the most overwhelming things to me as I study the life of Joseph is simply this, and that is the tremendous effort and the deliberation that God takes, and how it shows us how God deals with an individual that is committed and sold out to God's purposes, and how God prepares a person for those purposes. It's pretty hard for me to miss that when I look at the life of Joseph. In the last sermon from a couple of weeks ago, we left the story kind of in the middle of a bit of a longer story. For the sake of time and so on, we saw them in the banquet room of Joseph's home. The banquet room where most likely Joseph entertained heads of state from around the world. My imagination is that the banquet room was an ornately decorated place. It was a banquet room that was designed to leave a lasting impression on anyone who dined there. I am guessing that the meal that was served to the brothers was probably beyond anything that many of us have ever had the privilege of being served. My guess is that It was an experience that the brothers had never experienced before. Not only was the experience unlike anything they've ever experienced, but there was a certain something very mysterious about their encounter, if you remember, with this Zaphnath-Paneah, this Egyptian lord. They, of course, had no idea that it was Joseph, their own brother. And Zaphnath-Paneah has various different meanings. One is the savior of the world, but it also means something to the effect that he understands the times. He is a person who understands. And of course, Joseph did. He actually did understand what was going on. He understood the dynamics of what was happening in the lives of his brothers. And these brothers were a little slow catching on for all of the opportunistic perception qualities that these brothers had. While they recognized what was happening, they did not link it to Joseph, which I can't necessarily blame them. And as you remember, they were in the banquet room, and Joseph had them seated around the guest table. And to their astonishment and amazement, they were seated in order of age. Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, the whole way around the table until Benjamin, who was sat by himself at the end of the table in my imagination. And the servers come out of the kitchen, and all of the brothers get one large, tremendous portion and one personal server. But Benjamin, as we remember, got five portions served by five servers. Joseph did that to see if these brothers were still overcome by jealousy to the sons of the union of Jacob, their father, and Rachel, who of course was Jacob's favorite beloved wife. Now again, in my imagination, I can't prove this at all, but in my imagination, I picture a very large silver cup, perhaps something like I have here on the wall, a very ornate trophy cup. It was not any ordinary cup. It was something that was used to demonstrate the successes of Egypt, not only the material successes, but perhaps also the religious and other successes. The cup of Egypt was perhaps in that room. It was Joseph's personal cup. I can maybe imagine on the wall or in the wall a large trophy case. And since we're close to Super Bowl season, you can imagine the Lombardi Trophy and how organizations of the NFL protect their Lombardi trophies and how it points to their success as an organization or in some other way. It is a trophy that is virtually invaluable to any given organization. I imagine this cup being something similar to that. And in my imagination, the mood was light in the banquet room that day. And I can imagine the brothers looking around and observing all of the decorations. And they walk over to the trophy cabinet and they see this large, amazing silver cup, one of a kind. Perhaps Joseph explained some of the significance of this amazing cup, this trophy cup. Well, the banquet is over, and the sons of Jacob are on their way back to Egypt, back to Canaan, I'm sorry. But before they leave, a conspiracy takes place. And chapter 44 gives us the story of the last, perhaps the last dealings, at least recorded in Scripture, of God's dealings with these brothers, and more specifically, Joseph's dealings with the brothers, and bringing them to the place where they recognize God working in their lives. Up to this time, and only in the prior trip, do we actually see these brothers coming to a place where they see and recognize and appreciate God's dealings in their own lives personally. And in our next chapter, chapter 45, we see Joseph revealing himself to the brothers. But there's still a couple of lessons that they have to learn, you see. Well, chapter 44 is divided, in, at least in my opinion, into three sections. First of all, we have the conspiracy, which is the title of our sermon here today. Secondly, we have the confrontation in verses 4 to 13. And then following that, we have the confession, especially of the brothers, but particularly of Judah, who becomes the spokesman and in our study today becomes a type of Jesus Christ. The confession of the brothers. Let's look at these sections one by one. Now, earlier in life, Joseph had been conspired against by his brothers. We remember the story, the conspiracy of the brothers against him. It was a conspiracy of jealousy and a conspiracy of hatred. It was based on their extreme resentment and jealousy, their distaste of Joseph as an individual and also what he represented to the family. This conspiracy, however, the conspiracy of Joseph against his brothers, was not one of jealousy and hatred. Instead, it was a conspiracy of love and graciousness. This is an open and a dramatic attempt by Joseph to draw his brothers into fellowship with God, and beyond that, to draw the brothers and the family into a relationship with him. I especially want you to understand that. Now, these brothers had been involved in a bunch of conspiracies in their lives. In fact, much of their life story up to this point was being a conspirator. Conspiracies against each other. Conspiracies against people around them, the nomadic tribes and the clans around them. It was a conspiracy against each other at various times. And in at least one or more specific times, it was a conspiracy of the brothers against their own dad. All of these conspiracies involved trickery and deceit and secrecy. But these brothers are about to find out what it's like to live at the other end of conspiracies. And this is a conspiracy, at least in my opinion, to end all conspiracies. The conspiracy, of course, was planned of God. It was executed by Joseph and his steward, I should add, for the express purpose of bringing them face to face with their own sin. And the first three verses tell us what happens. The conspiracy actually wasn't that complicated. In verses 1 to 3, there's two things that are going on in this conspiracy. First of all, Joseph, as I mentioned earlier, is still testing the brothers to see if they have any leftover traits or sins in their lives that they have demonstrated and that were carryovers from what Joseph had experienced 22 years prior. First of all, Joseph is testing the brothers concerning their greed. Now, these brothers had learned well from their father Jacob and their grandfather Laban. And we looked at those stories in depth some months ago in one of the earlier sermons in this series of sermons, and we noticed how greed and accumulation was the name of the game. It was a part of this family that was one of the most defining traits that could be, their greed. They wanted to accumulate. They wanted to add assets and add value to the family clan, and of course, most importantly, to their own personal advantage. And Joseph, instead of taking the money that they brought to him to pay for the corn, he stashes the money back into their sacks, remember, and he gives it all back. In other words, the brothers and the family got food for free. And you remember that earlier in these lives, these brothers were sure accomplished materialists. They were so accomplished in their materialism, so focused on removal of all and any irritants in their lives, that they were willing to sell their own brother for a couple of pieces of silver each. 20 pieces of silver divided by 10 brothers. 2 pieces of silver each. And you also remember that the first time they came to Egypt to buy grain, Joseph had done the same thing. He had put the money into their sacks, which in essence meant free food, free corn. And their hatred and their fear that they felt when they saw and discovered the money in their sacks is something that's very interesting. In their case, they recognized it as blood money, and it brought guilt to their minds. Just why exactly that was the case, I don't know for sure, but it was incredible guilt nonetheless that they felt when they saw the money. The second part of this conspiracy is actually the biggest part of the conspiracy. Joseph tests their greed, but secondly, he particularly and very pointedly tests their grudge. Now, we know that how it was for, and he knew how it was for himself. When he was a young man, when he was the prince in Jacob's house, they resented him, and yeah, they just seriously couldn't stand him. And the cup in Benjamin's sack, well, let me just back up a little bit. The conspiracy is very clearly spelled out here. Joseph in cahoots with his steward. His steward was actually a lot like Joseph, a man who shared similar traits and could obviously talk Hebrew. My guess is that Joseph taught him Hebrew. The steward could communicate and probably was the interpreter between the brothers and Joseph. And the steward being privy of all that was going on, Joseph arranges with the steward to take the silver cup, the cup of Egypt, and place it into the sack of Benjamin's corn. Now, all of these brothers, in my imagination, probably had a group of donkeys that were piled with sacks of grain. Remember, they were taking corn back to the land of Canaan. Maybe it was a year's worth. I don't know. It was a sizable amount of corn, probably, for a clan their size. And I'm envisioning all of these brothers being responsible for a group of donkeys that were piled probably quite high with sacks of corn. Perhaps the donkeys and were also pulling wagons. But however it was, the steward puts the cup of Egypt, the trophy cup, into Benjamin's sack, along with the money that they had brought. Now, this was a double portion of money, not just the money from this last trip, but also the money from previous trips. Free corn, free food. Well, the cup in Benjamin's sack was like a time bomb that was about to find out if Benjamin would become a threat to the brothers, or if Benjamin was already a threat to the brothers, just like they had resented Joseph at one time for being the prince in their household, and just like he was a threat to the brothers, Joseph wanted to see if Benjamin was a threat to the brothers. What would the brothers do with Benjamin? How would they respond to Benjamin when this time bomb goes off? That was the question. Well, Joseph commands his steward to put the money from their trips to Egypt, put all of the money back into the sacks, and of course, put the silver cup, the trophy cup, in Benjamin's sack. Now watch what happens. In verses 4 to 15, well, the brothers get up in the morning, probably fairly early in the morning. These brothers were hardworking men. They were go-getters. And my imagination is that they were eager to get out of Egypt. Even though this trip had gone a little more smoothly than the time before, they were eager to get back into their comfort zone. So they get up early in the morning, and they start back toward Canaan. And these brothers were not real far out of town. Apparently, daylight had already, it was already daylight, and the conspiracy continues. Joseph commands his steward to take off after the brothers. The brothers did, of course, didn't know anything about this, and they're on their way home. And all of a sudden, there's this rider behind them that's overtaking them. This rider is coming hard. And suddenly they realize that there's something uncomfortable going on here. Well, the rider stops, and immediately levels an incredible accusation at them. He does not ask them. He tells them, and he says, "You took the cup. You took the silver cup. You stole the trophy cup of Egypt." And just like that, well, you know how it is when somebody accuses you of something that, especially if you didn't do it, these brothers responded just like anyone else would. And they said, "Of course we didn't. What's up with this? There's no way we did that." And they go off to defend themselves. You can easily see, especially in verse 7, their cocky innocence. They think that this steward has completely fallen off his rocker. They knew they were innocent. They knew they didn't do it. The steward is accusing them of something that they had absolutely nothing to do with. And when you can watch them in your mind's eye, they're on the road, on the path, back to Canaan. You can easily see in your mind's eye, can't you, the brothers, 11 of them, talking to the steward, and they are dead sure that they are innocent. And they're about to prove this steward completely wrong. Well, the steward comes to them with some conditions. Not only does he say, "You stole the cup. Not only did you take the trophy cup of Egypt, but wherever this cup is found, and in whoever's sack it is found, that brother becomes a slave, and the rest of you are free. You go right on home. But the brother in whose sack this is found will be our slave." The brothers, of course, in their confidence of being innocent, made the steward, they negotiated with the steward here, and they said, "Nah, if it's in our sack, the brother in whose sack is found, that brother should be killed, and the rest of us will be your slaves." Verse 11 tells us that they speedily took down every man his sack to the ground. They were eager to prove this steward wrong. They started with Reuben and opened all of Reuben's sacks. And one by one, Simeon, Levi, Judah, all the way down to Zebulun, and there's no silver cup. And in my mind, I can picture when the last of Zebulun's sacks were opened, I can imagine them breathing a sigh of relief, because there's still this little distrust that they have with each other. Maybe Naphtali would pull something off like this. Maybe one of the brothers would do something sneaky like this. But when the last of Zebulun's sacks were opened, I can imagine them breathing a sigh of relief, because Benjamin would never do something like this. And the steward starts to pull down Benjamin's sacks one by one. And he gets, maybe in my mind, in my imagination, to the last sack. Of course, he had it marked. He knew all about it. And he reaches his hand into the sack, and he feels something hard. And he gets that sack of grain and puts it upside down right in front of all the brothers. And out into the glinty sunlight falls the cup of Egypt in Benjamin's sack, the trophy cup. And suddenly, these brothers who just a moment ago had been so cocky and so sure, they are suddenly filled with terror. And the Bible tells us that they tore their clothes. Interestingly enough, this is the third time in our story that we read of someone tearing their clothes. The first instance was when Reuben came to the pit. Remember, Reuben was not there when the brothers sold Joseph to the Midianite traders. And when Reuben comes back to the pit, he had intended to free Joseph. But when he discovers Joseph wasn't there, Reuben tore his clothes. The second instance in this story was when the brothers come back to Jacob with the bloody coat of Joseph. And of course, the deception is in high gear. And when Jacob sees the bloody robe of Joseph, he tears his clothes in severe anguish. And so for these brothers, the act of them tearing their clothes is a variety of emotions. It's a combination of things. But to put it in a nutshell, it couldn't have been worse than this. This was the worst possible, least imaginable situation, and they are totally afraid. Remember, the steward's condition was that the brother in whose sack this cup was found would be a slave. And in verses 13 to 15, the question is basically this. Had the brothers recovered of their jealousy? Are they now concerned with the welfare of Benjamin, who is the new prince in Jacob's house? Will they stand with Benjamin, or will they just wipe their hands? Something happened to Benjamin. We can't really tell what happened. And yeah, Benjamin's gone. Will they just throw Benjamin away like a broken toy and let him become Joseph's slave and go on back to Canaan without him? That was the test. You see, when these brothers were in the presence of Joseph in the banquet room, they could have masked their feelings about Benjamin. Remember, the stakes were pretty high. They came into Egypt with the overriding desire to impress this fearsome Egyptian lord. And things had gone pretty well. The mood had been pretty good. Nothing bad had happened. And most importantly, nothing had happened to Benjamin. So they could have masked their feelings. But in this case, at the butt of this conspiracy, if the brothers' hearts were still like they were 22 years prior, Benjamin stays and the brothers go home. That's how it was 22 years prior. And Joseph has to find out if that's still the case. Well, the Bible says that as soon as the cup was found in Benjamin's sack, everybody loads up their donkeys and they go straight back to the home, the office of Zaphnath-Paneah. They accompany Benjamin to his trial, as it were. And in verse 14, it makes it clear that Joseph was yet there. I can understand why. He knew that something was going to happen. And he stayed late from work. He didn't go to work early that day. He stayed at home. And I can imagine Joseph perhaps standing at the window and just watching and seeing if these brothers, what's going to happen? Is the rider going to come back with Benjamin in tow? Will the 10 brothers stand with Benjamin? And I can imagine a great deal of joy, a great deal of relief for Joseph as he sees the brothers, the whole caravan, come one, come all. They're all together. He must have been overjoyed to see it. Well, in verse 14, they get back to the house that they had just left hours prior to that. They're back in the presence of this fearsome lord, this man of Egypt. And Joseph is still playing the game to the hilt. In verse 15, he says, "Don't you realize what you did? This trophy cup, this cup that represents all that is amazing about Egypt, all that's good. Don't you realize that it is my personal trophy? Don't you realize that I use this for religious purposes and that a man like me has the ability to divine? I knew you did it, he says. But the brothers still haven't figured it all out, you see, and they are totally terrified and totally afraid. And we're going to turn now to Judah's confession, and maybe more importantly, Judah's intercession in verses 16 to 34. And I find this so interesting and so amazing, because at this point, Judah becomes a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus' ancestor, Judah, plays the role that in this case makes him a type of Jesus Christ, his own descendant. We've noticed earlier that it seems as if Judah has become entrenched as the leader of this clan, this family. Back before they left for Egypt, he asserts to Jacob that he personally is responsible. If something happens to Benjamin, he will bear the blame forever. In addition to that, we noticed how that in prior times, especially chapter 38, he was not with the family. He had sort of left the clan and was on his own. But prior to this trip into Egypt, he apparently was back with the family. A lot has happened to Judah, which we talked about over a period of 20 years in chapter 38. Judah has discovered what it's like to be under the hand of God. And whatever all of those reasons are, the scenery has completely changed for Judah. And we can see it here in his speech. We can notice the change that has come to Judah. And I think it's typical of the change that has come over all of those brothers. Judah steps before Joseph, and he takes responsibility for the whole clan. And it's so amazing how he starts to confessing the sin that they had committed. Look at what it says in verse 16. Judah said, "What shall we say unto my Lord? What shall we speak? How shall we clear ourselves? God," he said, "hath found out the iniquity of thy servants. Behold, we are thy Lord's servants, both we and he also with whom the cup is found." I don't know how in the world Joseph could keep a straight face. In fact, in just a few moments, at least going to extend into our next chapter, he can't keep a straight face anymore. Judah, in verse 18, gets even closer to Joseph. He steps up, and I can imagine Joseph sitting perhaps on his throne, or maybe at a place where he's in some sort of behind a table, or there's some sort of distance. And Judah comes even closer. In addition to saying that God has found out the iniquity of the brothers, we are guilty, he says. We did it. God has found us out. We're guilty. And the rest of the chapter here, Judah gives one of the most impressive and remarkable pieces of literature that you'll ever find anywhere. In verse 18, in very passionate terms, Judah intercedes for his brother Benjamin. And this prayer of Judah before Joseph is an illustration, I believe, of how we should intercede. Joseph in the story here is a type of God. And Judah is a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. And maybe by extension, a type of a Christian. It shows us a bit of how we should pray, of how we should intercede for the needs of people around us. And I'm so challenged by this as I think of it. First of all, in Judah's intercession, he gives tremendous respect and reverence for Joseph's position. Look at verse 18. Here is Judah showing reverence, showing honor, showing awe and respect for Joseph, who stands before them, Judah says, in the place of God. When it comes to interceding for people in prayer, friends, brothers and sisters, God is always worthy of our honor and our praise and our sense of majesty. And when this piece is missing in our intercession, it becomes a very selfish prayer if we're not careful. In modern Christianity, we often attempt to grab the honor for ourselves. And we come to God in prayer with some selfish motives sometimes, trying to bring God down to our level so that God can understand the communication somehow. And in my understanding, in my thinking, this is reverse theology. We are never to bring God down to our level. It should be our attempt to go to his level. Judah does that. He comes a little closer to Joseph. He steps up to the plate, as it were. He steps up into the presence of God, and he starts to intercede. Not Joseph on Judah's level, but Judah on Joseph's level. He respects Joseph's position. The Bible says, "Be ye holy as I am holy," 1 Peter 1:16. I cringe sometimes when I hear phrases, hopefully not from us, but from maybe Christians at large or God-fearing people at large, where we use phrases such as the man upstairs or the dodger in the sky or some other trite phrase that we come up with to refer to God. Judah doesn't do that. He understood. He understood that the proper way to come before Joseph was with reverence and awe. I'm afraid sometimes that we have a tendency to become too familiar with God in our language and most of all in our attitude. Secondly, Judah reviews Joseph's proposals. He reviews Joseph's proposal. In verses 19 to 24, Judah sort of rehearses to Joseph as if Joseph may have forgotten. But he rehearses all the things that Joseph had asked them to do and how they had responded to it. "You told us to do this, and we did it. You gave us the instruction, and we followed it. You want to have power in your prayer when you intercede?" Brothers and sisters, power comes from obedience. A response to God that comes from a heart of obedience. John 15, verse 7. John 15, verse 7. Listen as I read. John 15, 7. "If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you." 1 John chapter 3, verses 21 and 22. "Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. And whatsoever ye ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments," he says, "and do the things that are pleasing in his sight." Verse 24. "And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit that he hath given us." If you want to have power in prayer, the precedent is obedience. And Judah stands before Joseph, and as he intercedes for Benjamin, the strength of his intercession is locked in the fact that they, the brothers, had been obedient. Thirdly, Judah restates the problem. Here's the problem. Judah says, "If we go back without Benjamin, our father is not going to be able to take it. He's going to die. There's no way that we can go back without Benjamin. There's no way. It's going to mean the death of our father." I don't know about you, but some of the best praying that I've ever done in my life was in times just like this, when I was at the end. There was no possible way going forward, it seemed. And I get alone with God, just me and God. And I pour out my heart to God and I give him all the details, as if he doesn't know it. The temptation for us is to think that God already knows my problem. And so why pray? Why remind God? Why go through all the stuff with God? Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 says that we are to bring our requests to God, make them known unto God. It says in Philippians 4, 6. What happens when we pour out our hearts to him and tell him all the details. One of the things that happens is it causes us to look at the problem from a different perspective. When we pour the problem out to God, it changes our perspective. We tend to look at the problem differently than we did before. And now, fourthly, at the end of this passionate prayer, Judah requests mercy, not justice. He does not plead for anything but mercy. Verses 32 to 34. It is most interesting to me that after he has acknowledged Joseph's position, after he has reviewed Joseph's requirements of the brothers, after he's laid out the whole problem, he comes to the very heart of the prayer. And the very heart of the problem is that Judah wants mercy. He knows in his heart that they're innocent. But in the sight of this Lord, that is not up for discussion. He begs Joseph for mercy. And his prayer in a nutshell is simply this. He comes to Joseph and he asks him for something. Judah gets down and tells it to Joseph exactly what it is. Let me stay instead of Benjamin. I pledged my life to our father. I'm responsible. Let Benjamin go. Let me take the consequences. He begs Joseph to let him stay instead of Benjamin. Because if Benjamin doesn't go back to Canaan, Jacob is going to die. His willingness to lay down his life for his brother. And that way, Judah typifies himself to his descendant, the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 John 3:16, hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Intercession is basically a prayer for the consequences to be on me, not on the other person, the person that we're praying for. In the Bible, we see numerous illustrations of this. Moses did it. Daniel did it. Ezra, Nehemiah, they did it. And of course, I would be remiss to mention that Jesus Christ himself did it. When he took on him the penalty and the punishment for the sins of the whole world, he became sin for us, even though he had not done anything wrong for us. It's a great illustration of intercessory prayer. And it's no wonder to me, as Judah finishes this prayer, that Joseph can't restrain himself any longer. And in our next sermon, we're going to see it. I don't know how I'm going to get through it. But when Judah gets done with his speech, Joseph is done. He's finished. The tough mask is gone. There's three lessons that I see from chapter 44 that we should not miss. Joseph's reasons for doing all of this, and this is somewhat a rehearsal of some of the things that I've said earlier. The lessons that I see here in this chapter, and that is simply the question, why did Joseph wait so long to reveal himself? How come when the brothers a year earlier had been there, why didn't he just go out and say, hey guys, I'm Joseph. I'm here to help you. I'll get you through this. And he rehearses the whole story of how he's been promoted in Egypt. He doesn't do that. He bides his time. Instead, he puts them through the paces, sends them back, keeps Simeon, puts the money and the silver cup into the sack and all of that. And the reasons he's doing this is because he knows. He needs to understand. He needs to have a better understanding whether or not they had repented. He must know whether or not they had repented of their prior sins. Well, Judah gets down on his knees before Joseph, not knowing, of course, that it was Joseph. And he says, listen to me now. We're guilty. We did it. Joseph gave them enough time so that he could discern the genuineness of their repentance. The second reason Joseph waited to reveal himself to the brothers was because he wanted to see if their repentance had steered them away from their self-centeredness. He wants to see not only if they were sorry for what had happened, not only are they acknowledging what had happened, like documenting their failures, but he wanted to see if they were still self-centered or not. How did they feel toward each other? How were they treating one another? When Joseph was growing up with these brothers, they were jealous and cruel and violent. And now he looks up from his throne right there in his house, and he sees brothers that have each other's backs, especially the one who has been implicated, Benjamin. What has happened? Something has caused these brothers to understand that life is not bound up in the things that we accumulate and do for ourselves and our own pursuits, but it's bound up in what we can do for others. Not only did the brothers need to understand that, but I need to understand that. We need to understand that for ourselves. I've discovered in my life that there is nothing that reveals our attitude toward God more than our attitude toward others. The Bible says if we do it unto the least of these, we do it to Him. These brothers are openly saying that we're not going to stand for Benjamin staying here in Egypt. We're not going to go home without Benjamin. We're here. You got all of us or none. These same brothers who were so ruthlessly had sold Joseph into Egypt, now obviously something had happened to them. The third thing that Joseph wanted to see, he wanted to know if they had come to see God at work in their hearts, in their lives. You see, earlier in their lives, they had brazenly rejected God's word to them. And one of the only words of God that I can see to them was Joseph's dreams. And for all you can say about how Joseph handled that, that really was a word from God for this family. And they had simultaneously rejected that word from God. Categorically rejected it. What Joseph is saying is that they now realize that God has brought all of this on their lives. God has allowed this distress to come on their lives. In closing, I tell you the story of a young man named John, who was born in a Christian home. He lived under Christian influence in Great Britain many centuries ago. His parents died when he was still a very young boy, and it put him into the system, or quite candidly, turned him into a street boy in the streets of London. He lied about his age to get favors when he was a teenager. He joined the Royal Navy of England and learned how to navigate a ship. But wherever he went, trouble found him. He was a troublemaker. He deserted the Navy, escaped to Africa, and one thing led to the other, and he was captured by an old-fashioned human trafficking scheme. And in his case, he became slave to a black woman who took great delight in mistreating this white Britisher. She would throw his food on the floor and force him to eat off the floor like a dog. Sometimes she would tie him up for no reason and beat him. And finally, he couldn't stand it anymore, and he found a way and escaped. He managed to escape. He ran to the African shore and built a fire to attract a ship that he could see in the distance. And the ship stopped and picked him up. Well, the shipmaster, who was a Britisher, gave him a job. And he was able to work his way up until he became the navigator of that ship. But John was a real prodigal. It seemed that no matter what happened, he would always manage to get into trouble. He started to drink, and he drank to the point where he was drunk all the time. He couldn't do his job as a navigator. And because he was a troublemaker, and because he was a drunkard, and he became a total nuisance and a liability on the ship. And one day, after a particularly troublesome day, the shipmaster threw John into the prison of the ship. While he was there in that dungeon, you can't get much worse than that, in a prison, a ship prison. And he was there in that dungeon. He began to think about the early years of his life and the godly influence that his parents had been on him. He remembered the things that his parents had taught him about God, and he starts to reason with himself, and he says, John, there's no way for me to live like this. There's a better way. And John turned his heart to the Lord in that prison and became a changed man. And before John died, he wrote many hymns that have inspired us to this day. John Newton wrote songs like Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds, and his best-known hymn, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound That Saved a Wretch Like Me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. John Newton saw and realized that the hand of God was on his life, and he used all of those experiences to bring him back into fellowship with God. You see, John Newton started to give credit for all of those areas to God, and that same thing has happened to these brothers. Well, when Joseph saw that the brothers had begun to give God credit for the things that had happened into their lives, even the weakest and worst things that they had ever happened to those brothers, it was time for the next step, and that next step is the revelation. If you're able, I invite you to kneel with me in prayer. Lord God, our Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you that you became man, that you dwelt among us and became our brother. And we thank you, Lord, that you intercede for us.